The Fall and Death of Adam. I have been following with keen interest the debate between Don Preston and Ed Stevens, and feel at this stage it right to make comment. I am from the UK, and it may be there are others in the UK who are following the debate too, and would like to comment. Don Preston's view of the death of Adam seems to me to be not right, and it jars against the grain. The death that Adam and Eve was threatened with was manifold. His transgression of the commandment not to eat of the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil brought with it a felt sense of guilt, shame for their nakedness, a loss of knowledge, thinking that they could hide from the presence of God. Their sin opened up to them and their posterity all manner of sufferings and of evils, ailments, sicknesses, the potential for all manner of sinful thoughts, actions, which would be judged by God. Thorns, thistles, wild animals, harsh weather conditions, famine, drought, locusts, thunderstorms, hail, beasts, pestilence of livestock, etc. Prone to accidents and a rightful fear of corporal death. Then corporal death, leading to a judgment for sin. And to those not in Christ, eternal death, a second death, with a conscious, eternal sense of the wrath of God against their sins. The death mentioned in Scripture came into the world through sin, the sin of Adam and Eve. There is a death referred to in Ephesians which reads, "And you hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein, in time past, ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience." There is a death of affliction. 2 Corinthians 11 reads, "Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they the seed of Abraham? So am I. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool, I am more, in labours more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons oft, in deaths often." There's a death of darkness, as found in Exodus. Exodus 10, 17. "Now therefore, forgive, I pray thee, my sin, only this once, and entreat the Lord your God that he may take away from me this death only." And there is, of course, corporal death. "For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is also dead." And there is a second death. "And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire." This is the second death. Only man was condemned for this death of sin, the sin of Adam and Eve. Angels were not subject to this kind of death described above, for the elect angels never sinned. They are spiritual and do not have corporal bodies. They are impeccable, being preserved in Christ, and they are holy, and not subject to any kind of death. Fallen angels were cast out from the presence of God, and not subject to the blessings of God that men are, but rather under eternal condemnation. The redemption that is in Christ is from the death that was threatened, and the death sentence that was passed upon Adam in the day that he sinned. This redemption is by his atoning, propitiatory sacrifice, his death, resurrection, ascension, and high priestly work in heaven. This redemption does not mean the elect are safe from temporal evils or from experiencing pain, injustice, and many evils threatened, or corporal death. Their salvation is from their sins, the guilt of their sins, the judgment due at a future penal judgment. The gift of salvation involves all spiritual blessings: regeneration, adoption, justification, forgiveness of sins, the gift of imputed righteousness, and the promise of a glorified, immortal, impeccable body after the image and fashion of Christ's glorious body himself. And so, multitudes of men and women saved to sin no more. These spiritual blessings being purchased by Christ, the only eternal begotten Son of God the Father, himself for the elect from Adam throughout all time. Upon Adam's sin, the Lord stepped in to deliver Adam and Eve from the sad effects of that death and the sentence that had been passed by providing a typical substitutionary sacrifice for sin and making them coats of skin to cover their nakedness, which was typical of the righteousness of our Lord Jesus Christ, a covering from all sin and uncleanness. Eve was also informed of the effects of her part in the transgression, which abides to this day. The promise of deliverance from their fallen condition was made by the Lord himself, by his announcement to the serpent, Genesis 3:15, "And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." Adam and Eve taught their children all about the fall and were the first preachers of the gospel. We have good reason to believe and understand they both believed the promise of God, and like Abraham, it was counted unto them for righteousness. In other words, they experienced the new birth, received the spirit of adoption, were justified by faith, and looked to the Lord for all the blessings of those things that accompany salvation. It appears to me that the failure to understand the nature of the redemption that is in the Lord Jesus Christ stems from a failure to understand the nature of our death in Adam, which we all know something about. It would be wrong to believe and teach that the all who died in Adam are made alive in Christ. Though all men died in Adam, all men are not saved in Christ. For all men were not raised with Christ at his resurrection. For those interested in learning more about these things, please take a look at John Gill's Body of Doctrinal Divinity, Book 3 of The External Works of God. Subject matter listed below. Access by the links provided at the bottom of this video. A PDF copy is available upon request for free, or a hard copy can be purchased from Amazon. Access via the link provided at the bottom of this video.